Welcome to part 2 of the fog rendering chapter from the ShaderX 2 book. If you missed the first part, make sure to watch it before this video. You can find the link in the video description below. We have a couple of really cool fog techniques for today, but before we do that, I'd like to say a huge thank you to Hao Chen for joining the OpenGL Underground. If you too would like to support this channel, you can do that at patreon.com/OGLDEV. And now we can start. The fourth fog technique in this chapter is the layered fog. Take a look at this before we examine the theory. It's an interesting type of fog which adds a vertical aspect to the visual appearance. This fog depends on two types of distances, the regular maximum distance as well as the maximum height. The layered fog technique in the ShaderX book is based on a single page by Justin Legakis titled Fast Multi-Layer Fog, and you can find the link in the video description. As usual with research papers, they assume that the reader is also a researcher and has prior knowledge in that domain. I don't have a PhD in 3D graphics, so I'll try to explain this as best as I can. The article by Justin Legakis begins with a general formula to calculate the fog factor. This formula is similar to our exponential fog in the sense that E is raised to the power of some coefficient. However, the coefficient is now the integral of a general fog density function, which is called alpha. If you're not familiar with calculus, then it suffices to say that to integrate a function between two points means to calculate the area enclosed by the function and the x-axis in between these two points. In the following image, we can see a general function f. The integral of f between a and b is the blue and yellow regions above and below the x-axis. Calculus provides us the tools to calculate this area through a process called integration. In pure graphics research, the fog is approximated using a very complex function that takes into account several aspects of light such as absorption, emission, scattering, and inscattering. The final fog effect is calculated by integrating this function from the viewer to the pixel, because this way we can sum up the contribution of each particle along the way. In his paper, Justin tried to simplify this model in order to render the layered fog in real time. Basically, the problem is reduced to three parameters: y1, which is the height of the camera, Y2, the height of the pixel, and delta D, which is the horizontal distance from the camera to the pixel on the XZ plane. Delta D is very easy to calculate using the Pythagorean theorem. We are traveling on the XZ plane, so there is no change in Y. Therefore, according to the theorem, the distance is simply the root of the sum of squares of delta X and delta Z. Next, we need to tackle the integral of the fog density function from the camera to the pixel. The simplification that was done here is the decision that the density changes only as a function of the height. This means that we can rewrite the integral as an integral from y1 to y2. This brings us to the following equation with two cases. If there is no change in height, the factor is simply the product of delta D and the density at height y1. If there is a change, we have the following function. At this point, I'd like to say a special thank you to my math advisor Baruch Ziv for helping me understand the transition from left to right in this equation. It requires a higher level of calculus, which I will not show here. If you're interested, you can find the link in the video description to a proof provided by Baruch. Now we still need to do something about the integral from y1 to y2 because it's going to take place in a shader, and we want to make sure it doesn't slow us down. At this point, Marcus Newbull, the author of the ShaderX chapter, made another simplification. He decided to use a constant change in the fog density due to height differences between two points. In other words, the density function is simply y itself, so the integral in this case is half the square of delta y. This is really one of the simplest cases of function integration, and they teach you that in the first lecture of Calculus 1. Or 2, I don't remember, it was a long time ago. This brings us to the final equation of the fog density factor. Now, in order to actually implement this in a shader, Marcus made the observation that there are four different cases that depend on whether the camera and the pixel are above or below the maximum height and the combination between these two Boolean flags. Let's review these cases as we go through the code. We start by projecting the camera and the pixel on the XZ plane. This simply means setting the Y coordinate of their world space position to zero. We can now calculate delta D using the Pythagorean theorem, or simply use the GLSL function length as I did here. We also divide delta D by the maximum distance in order to make this a normalized fraction between 0 and 1. Next, we prepare two variables called delta Y and density integral, which will be calculated differently according to the specific case. We now begin to handle the four different cases. First, we handle the two cases where the camera is above the maximum height of the fog. This maximum height is provided by the application and represented here by the uniform variable layered fog top. If the pixel is also above the fog, then there is no fog. There is a straight line from the camera to the pixel entirely above the top of the fog. Delta Y and the density integral remain zero. We shall later see how this will make the fog factor 1, which is what we need in this case. If the pixel is below the fog, we calculate delta Y as the distance from the pixel to the top of the fog, and we normalize it by dividing by the maximum fog height. The density integral is calculated exactly as we saw, as half the square of delta Y. Now let's see the two cases where the camera is inside the fog. If the pixel is above the fog, it means that we only need to take into account the region between the camera and the top of the fog, because above that there is no fog. Delta Y is the distance from the camera to the top of the fog, again normalized by dividing by the maximum height. The density integral is calculated as usual. The final case is the most complex. Both the camera and the pixel are inside the fog. In that case, delta Y is the difference in height between them. Notice that we use the absolute function ABS to make sure we don't get negative values. In order to calculate the density integral, we calculate the integral function twice, for the camera and the pixel. The final density integral is the delta between them. We use the absolute function here as well. Now that we have delta D, delta Y, and the density integral, we use the equation from the article to calculate the final density. The fog factor is calculated by raising e to the power of negative density. The fog factor can now be propagated all the way back to the main function, and we use it to linearly interpolate between the color of the fog and the color of the pixel. This piece of code is common to all the fog techniques. The fifth and final technique in this chapter is the animated fog. This is simply a fog that changes over time, so for example, you can use it when you want to add the effect of wind blowing through the fog. The implementation is based on yet another paper titled Real-Time Animation of Realistic Fog by Beery, Michelin and Arquez, with a few modifications by Marcus himself. The authors of the paper suggested the use of periodic functions in order to create the animation. A periodic function is a function that repeats its values at regular intervals. The classic example is the trigonometric functions. The final periodic function that was presented in the paper is the sum of 1 and 4 fractions. Each fraction is based on the cosine function of pi multiplied by a scalar number, as well as one of the components of the world space position of the pixel. In a couple of cases, it's actually a combination of two components, and in the last coefficient, we see the product of two cosines, one for x and one for z. The authors didn't explain how they came up with this specific combination, and I don't think there's any magic going on here. I bet you can find other variations that achieve comparable results. I guess that they simply started with the basic cosine and made it more complex so that the result will not appear to be too regular. Anyway, This is the function that we're going to use, so let's take a look at the code because there are a few more points that we need to take care of. And first is the addition of the exponential fog to the final calculation of the fog factor. This was done by Marcus, and he claims that the reason is that the original implementation worked well for a static camera, but when the camera was moving, the periodic distribution was noticeable. I actually didn't notice it myself, but I kept the same implementation just in case. So the function calc_animated_fog_factor starts with the standard calculation of the exponential fog. Next, we calculate the animated fog coefficient according to the equation from the paper. Few things to notice here. First, the fog time is added to one of the terms. This term is based on z, and this makes the fog move along the z-axis. The fog time itself is calculated by the application in every frame. The formula is not in the book, but I was able to find it in the source DVD. As you can see, the fog time is based on the running time of the application in seconds. We also throw in a random factor to make things more interesting. The next thing to notice about the animation is that I divided the world space coordinate by 20. Using the unmodified value made the result too periodic, and this division stretched the cosine result and made it less noticeable. You may want to change this into a uniform as well and make it part of the animation. And finally, the entire animation factor is prefixed by the minus sign. This was also in the book. Without it, we lose most of the fog effect, so I guess this prevents some kind of an overflow of the final result. We can now calculate the final fog factor as a sum of the exponential fog and the animation factor. We also multiply the animation factor by the camera to pixel distance, divided by the maximum fog distance. This simply normalizes the animation factor. And here's the final result. I guess these last two techniques were quite complex, and I spent a lot of time going over the papers that were used as a reference for the book. Hopefully I was able to make things as clear as possible, so let me know what you think in the comments below. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next tutorial.